I don't want to ride a bike again ever at this moment. I finished day one, but I want to take my bike and throw it off the cliff. You watch, you know, watch any of these superhero movies, it's always good to have a nemesis, and you know, Batman needs to have the Joker, and I guess Rich Meeker's always been the Joker for me. And hi, Rich. He's just been a good rider for a long time. And in 2006, USA Cycling had a thing called the SoCal Cup. All year long, every race, you compete for points. They just keep tracking your progress as the year goes through. And then at the end of the year, then they award the SoCal Cup, which to me was like a really cool thing. I really wanted to win it. I had competed a few times in previous years and never really was in the hunt, but I was having a really good year, won a couple big races, and you know, as the stretch of the summer was going on, found myself in second or third, and Rich Meeker was, you know, way ahead. He was just, you know, seemed untouchable. But anyway, we got down towards the end, maybe it was August, and I think Rich decided that he was so far ahead in the SoCal Cup, or honestly, maybe he didn't care about it at all. Maybe he had a bunch of SoCal Cups in his, you know, in his house already. I don't know. So I thought to myself, like, I looked at the points. I'm not a big math guy, but I looked at the points, and there were two really big races left. There was the Mount Charleston Hill Climb, which is in Las Vegas, and it scores 20 points for the win. And then the next weekend, there's another race called the Everest Challenge. And that is 2 days of really, really, really hard riding. Whatever, I can't remember exactly how far behind I was, but I had figured out if I won, I could beat him by like 1 or 2 points. But I thought, okay, well, let's go to Mount Charleston. We'll try that. If I win there, then I'll go to the Everest Challenge. If I don't, then there's really no reason to do it, because second place at Mount Charleston won't give me enough points. So I end up winning there, and I was pretty excited. I had a great race, feeling really good, beat some fast guys, and then set my sights on the Everest Challenge. But again, I think I said earlier, I was being a little sneaky, and so I didn't want Rich to know that I was gonna do the Everest Challenge, because if he saw that, and again, this is in my head, again, he probably couldn't have given a crap. He was drinking beer and like having a great time, doing whatever Rich Meeker does. So I'm thinking I gotta wait for the last minute to register. And like if it's 10 o'clock PM, you know, I wanted to push the button for my, you know, race entry, because then it like adds you to a list. And I didn't want him to see, because I'm sure, you know, my head, he's watching the computer and updating it every few minutes to make sure that I'm not entering this. But I thought, I could snake Meeker if I could just get in there. So day one, I've got a buddy, Louie, who has won the pro race of the Everest Challenge more times than you can even count. And just a great friend, and this guy Sherpas me the whole way. Like he tells me what to do, what not to do. I've got my ex-wife Maggie following in the car, and she would come to these races, and this thing, she's following us for 6 hours or whatever this thing ends up being, and then she's able to kind of help people along the way if they're like out of food or water or something. She's helping them, and I'm in second place. I mean, Louie's with me, so we're second and third. And there's one guy that somehow got away with the Pro 1-2 guys, and I never see him again after the first hour of the ride. So that guy wins, I get second. So I'm in really good shape, because all I have to do is get 2 third places. So I'm already ahead of the game, but I have to have a good ride tomorrow. And I've been so worried about cramping that I'm drinking just so much. I'm taking those little hydration pills, like salt tablets and all kinds of stuff. And all it really does is, well, I didn't cramp, so I guess it did what it was supposed to do. But from the moment I finished until I woke up the next I don't know, midnight, I was peeing every 15 minutes. I mean, I had to pee every 15 minutes. Like, all through dinner, I think I had to pee like four times, like while we're trying to eat some dinner. I'm so packed with, like, I'm just so hydrated I almost can't even sit still. I've got to pee like every few, and so I'm like, this is wrong. Like, I don't want to ride a bike again. I can barely sit down. So day two comes, and day two is a lot easier, still hard. We start on the first climb, and a spoke breaks on my back wheel. And I'm like, uh-oh, this is not great. Cause like my backup wheel that I have is got a 23 cog in the back. And if I've got to climb for 2 hours up that last climb, there's no way I don't think I can climb it in the 23. I really need something bigger. And so I roll to the back of the group, you know, raise my hand, try not to let anybody know so that they don't attack or anything. You just like kind of sneak to the back. I raise my hand. And so Maggie is back there with the car. She comes up, trade the wheels out. And then I'm catching back on. But like, as I'm riding, she's just driving right next to me. And I'm telling her, okay, you got a job here. You have got to find me another wheel, and it has to have bigger than a 28, like a 28 or bigger. It has to. And so she goes, okay, great, I got it. So she goes back. She doesn't follow us for a while. We go up, we do the second, we finish the first climb, go to the second climb, do that. The group's starting to splinter a little bit. And at the bottom of the second climb, we're getting ready to do the other one. She comes up next to me and she says, I can't find one. And I'm like, wait, no. See, you have to find this. You have to. I can't climb it without. And so she goes, okay. You know, like a renewed, like, understanding of how serious it is. Again, bless her heart, she's a saint. She goes down to the bottom of the hill as we're coming down too, and she finds a guy who is dropping out of the race. Like, he's had enough, he's packing his car up, and somehow she talks him into giving his back wheel up. And so I stop there, put the new wheel on, start up. I swear to God, I'm in that gear the whole, it's a 28. I don't get out of the 28 the entire climb for 2 hours. And I'm out of this, I think I climbed the whole thing pretty much out of the saddle, along with some other guys. And I end up with just Louie and then this guy that won the first day. And the guy that won the first day, he's really gracious. You know, I think by now I've told him the story of how I'm trying to beat Richard Meeker, and this is, you know, such a big deal. He just says to me, he goes, look, I know you don't need to win, but I'm not gonna challenge you in the sprint. So just, you get the win. And so we get to the top of this thing, I win the race, win the SoCal Cup. Again, like, probably Rich doesn't even know until just this moment that he lost the SoCal Cup in 2006. He probably didn't even, he probably didn't know that. But thank you, Rich. You're a good nemesis. And that was my fun at winning the SoCal Cup in 2006.